Good afternoon, colleagues. The first item of business will be portfolio questions, and of course I'm required to remind the members not to move around the chamber in a non-safe way, and I'm now looking for my piece of paper, thank you very much, to get the script. So that social distancing measures are in place in the chamber and across the Holyrood campus, I ask that members take care to observe these measures, including when entering and exiting the chamber. Please only use the aisles and walkways to access your seat and when moving around the chamber. So the first portfolio questions today is finance and the economy. And I would point out that questions 3 and 7 are grouped together and that I'll take any supplementaries on these questions after both have been answered. In general, if a member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press their request to speak button or indicate in the chat function by entering the letter R during the relevant question. And again, we will get through more questions and answers if we could have succinct questions and succinct answers, please. Question number one, Liz Smith.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what revenue it estimates it will receive from land and buildings transaction tax in 21-22.
Minister Tom Arthur.
The Scottish Fiscal Commission is the independent body responsible for forecasting revenues for the fully devolved taxes. In Scotland's economic and fiscal forecasts, published on 28 January of this year, the SFC forecasts that the Scottish Government will receive £586 million in revenue from a land and building transaction tax in 2021-22.
Liz Smith.
Could I thank the Minister for that response? Would he agree, however, that for many young first-time buyers in areas of very high house prices, where there are many properties over the 250,000 rate at which the LBTT kicks in, this on top of other taxes that they're paying is quite prohibitive? So can I ask the Scottish Government if it has plans to introduce some regional schemes where there can be more targeted support for aspirational families, or at least plans which provide tangible support through mortgage assistance?
Minister.
Now, thank the member for her question. The Scottish Government does provide support through the first-time buyer relief, which effectively raises the nil band from £145,000 to £175,000, which effectively means that 8 out of 10 of first buyers do not pay any tax. With regards to a regional scheme, I recognise this is an area that the Conservative Party have some interest in. I would be open to receiving more information on what Liz Smith's proposals would be, but I would caution that LBTT is a national tax and we would have to be cautious about introducing unnecessary complexity into the system in doing such a localised methodology.
Thank you. Question number two, Lorna Slater.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what action it will take to ensure that money invested in the economic recovery by way of grants, loans and other funding will support fair work practices and climate obligations for any companies that receive such support.
Cabinet Secretary Richard Lockhead.
Can I add my welcome to Lorna Slater to Parliament and say to her that fair work is central to our economic recovery and renewal, and through Fair Work First, we're applying Fair Work criteria to public sector grants, contracts and other funding wherever possible and where it's relevant to do so. We continue to consider how we can use all our levers to support a green recovery and expect those accessing financial support to publicly align with Scottish Government values, particularly those relating to our climate and environmental ambitions. And securing the full range of employment powers, of course, would enable the Scottish Government to fully implement policies that best meet Scotland's distinct needs, enabling us to create more good green jobs with Fair Work at their heart and a more prosperous Scotland.
Lorna Slater.
Thank you for your answer. In order to support a green recovery, will the Minister commit to ensuring that investment money, whether as grants, loans or other funding, will come with conditions to ensure that this money goes not only to businesses who support Fair Work, which I approve your support of, but also that support a sustainable economy, for example, only to go to companies who pay living wages, who don't use zero-hour contracts or tax havens, and who have plans to achieve emissions that are in line with our national targets as agreed by this Parliament? And how would the Minister follow up to ensure that any applicable conditions were being met?
Cabinet Secretary.
I generally agree with the principles outlined by Lorna Slater, and of course much of what she says relates to the Fair Work agenda that is being implemented by the Scottish Government at the moment, and indeed as part of our first 100 days commitments we're reviewing Fair Work First criteria to oppose, for instance, unfair fire and rehire tactics and promote flexible and family-friendly working. And we're also working with the Poverty Alliance and building in the Living Wage Employer Accreditation, which was referred to by the member, so we can also introduce a living hours scheme for Scotland in the first 100 days of this new government as well. So I just want to assure the member we're exploring every possibility to ensure that our grants and support for businesses and organisations across Scotland are aligned with the Scottish Government and indeed the Scottish Parliament's values.
Thank you. Question number... Yes, I am indeed going to call Paul Sweeney for a supplementary.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Will the Government commit, further to the question by Lorna Slater, to making trade union recognition for large companies with more than 250 employees a precondition of applying for further government support?
Minister.
In terms of the Fair Work agenda, these are issues that are already reflected in the principles that we promote as part of our grants and so on and so forth. And the Fair Work First criteria has already been applied to £619.8 million worth of contracts awarded by the Scottish Government. And employers' relationships with trade unions and workers' voices is part of that Fair Work First and Fair Work agenda. So yes, we are exploring again further ways in which we can promote these principles. And as a new minister into this portfolio, I'm very keen personally to make sure we leave no stone unturned.
Thank you, Minister. I think I had promoted you momentarily there. Question number three, Audrey Nicol.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support it will make available to businesses in light of the continuation of the current COVID-19 restrictions.
Cabinet Secretary Kate Forbes, who is joining us remotely. Thank you.
I'd like to welcome Audrey Nicol to her place and look forward to working with her. We recognise the impact that deviating from the route map has had on businesses across Scotland, perhaps more so in certain areas than others. And that's precisely why we've provided additional financial support to those businesses in areas where it's been necessary to unfortunately retain restrictions for an additional period. We'll continue to prioritise business support as much as we can within our limited resources, and we'll continue to press the United Kingdom Government for additional funding to be made available for businesses, because there hasn't been additional consequentials for business support since the election.
Audrey Nicol.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her answer, and I know from speaking to many businesses in my own constituency that the support already made available by the Scottish Government has been an absolute lifeline. While some restrictions remain in place, understandable concerns have been raised about the UK Treasury's failure to announce an extension to the furlough scheme, which is due to be scaled back from the 1st of July. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide reassurance that she is doing everything that she can to press the UK Government to extend the furlough scheme in order to give businesses in Scotland the financial support needed until our economy can fully reopen?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would agree with Audrey Nicol. We have consistently called for furlough funding to remain in place for as long as it's needed. And we've been here before. Last October, I think the Chancellor re-announced support plans almost five times before finally confirming that he would extend furlough. So it is absolutely essential that the UK Government commits to the furlough scheme. We have called on them also to change the rules that require contributions to the cost of the scheme from July, and that currently exclude people who have started a new job since the 2nd of March from being furloughed. People who have been required to stop working to protect others should be supported as much as possible.
Pam Gosel, question 7.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what engagement it has had with the business sector regarding the current COVID-19 regulations.
Cabinet Secretary.
Welcome Pam Gosel to her place. I think this is the first time we have had an exchange in the Parliament. We have engaged extensively with businesses and their representative organisations during the pandemic. I don't think a single workday has probably gone by without some form of engagement. And indeed, officials counted that between March and December 2020, more than 820 engagements took place. There's a regular weekly programme of engagement, which continues with business leaders, including the CBI, FSB, Institute of Directors, the Chambers, the SCDI, Scottish Financial Enterprise, Scottish Retail Consortium, Scottish Tourism Alliance and Scottish Food and Drink. And immediately after I was sworn in, the first thing I did was meet with that group to discuss a range of priority issues. I also discussed the latest restrictions with them yesterday.
Pam Gozo.
Could I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response? Cabinet Secretary, one sector which has been complaining bitterly about its current circumstances is those providing contact services such as beauty therapy and spa treatments. They have lost out on the availability of business restart grants because they have been classified as non-essential retail, which is an inaccuracy that needs to be urgently addressed. Will the Cabinet Secretary agree to ensure those services are properly reclassified in the future?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think there's some misunderstanding about the restart scheme. Separately to that, we are one of the only places in the UK that actually put in place a specific funding stream for close contact services, for mobile close contact services, to try and reach what is a predominantly self-employed sector with additional support. In terms of the restart grants, we provided the smaller restart grant in line with what the rest of the UK did for those businesses that were able to open before others and reserve the larger restart grants in line with the rest of the UK for those businesses that restarted later on. That remains our position and I have no intention of changing that.
Willie Rennie.
The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that there's a lobby outside Parliament today from the travel industry. They can't understand why they've effectively been shut down by the restrictions, that they've received very little financial support in return for months. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that the level of restrictions should match the level of financial support made available by the government?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I know Willie Rennie has been an advocate for the travel industry for a number of months. And of course, he will recall the fact that we put in place a specific fund for travel agents, as well as for the inbound tour sector and the wider tourism sector that relies on international travel. And again, I think we were one of the few places that did that. However, I absolutely understand that some sectors are being impacted for longer because of a lack of international travel. I know the sector more than anything else wants those restrictions to be lifted, which we intend to do on a four nations basis as far as possible. And in the meantime, looking at additional support is very challenging because of a lack of additional consequential funding. But Ivan McKee, the Minister for Tourism, has written to the UK government specifically on the issue of the travel industry's need for additional business support to look at whether additional consequences could be made available to support that sector.
Tess White.
Presiding Officer, today is a day of action at the airport. Sadly, the route from Aberdeen to Manchester is now to close. Is the government prepared to meet with the airports to discuss a plan so that jobs can be saved?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the Cabinet Secretary for Transport has met regularly with the airport sector and the wider aviation sector since the pandemic first hit last March, and we remain in close contact with them. We, of course, were, again, one of the few parts, if not the only part of the UK, to extend non-domestic rates relief to the airport industry in light of the challenges that they face. We'll continue to keep in close contact with them. I know that ultimately what they want to see is a removal of restrictions. We want to do that on a four nations basis when it is safe to do so, when we see that the vaccination programme is making good progress across the world.
Thank you. Question number four, Claire Baker.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government how it is supporting the economic recovery of town centres.
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I will shortly be setting out plans for a Scotland Loves Local loyalty card scheme and a £10 million Scotland Loves Local programme to help revitalise town centres hit by the pandemic. We are working with COSLA and partners to respond to the ambitious vision for our town centres and the recommendations to deliver it set out in the recent Town Centre Review Report, A New Future for Scotland's Town Centres. All of this is underpinned by our £325 million place-based investment programme, which will accelerate our ambitions for place, 20-minute neighbourhoods and town centre revitalisation.
Claire Baker.
Thank you. While the pandemic has accelerated the collapse of many large retailers in our town centres, including Kirkcaldy and Dunfermline, this was already a feature of high streets across Scotland. They are owned by private companies and private investors, but we do lead a public sector response to the challenge that we're facing. So the Minister mentioned some projects, but what is there to incentivise the repurposing of large units to support local authorities in their efforts to invest in change in town centres, which will need, I think, a significant investment, and for the public to have a stake in the decisions which impact on their high streets and their environment?
Minister.
Can I thank Claire Baker for her supplementary? I think she raises a lot of important points. What I would highlight is these are all ideas that are live and relate to our response to the Town Centre Review. That is due to be published later in the year. I would also draw the member's attention to our retail strategy, which is also due for publication later in the year. And finally, as Planning Minister, I will be laying a draft of the National Planning Framework 4 in Parliament later in the year in the autumn. And I'm very keen within this portfolio to make sure that all of these areas align. In particular, I recognise the point, I think it's implicit in what the member makes, which is the need to ensure more community ownership in our town centres. And indeed, as the Minister responsible for social entrepreneurship and employee ownership, this is an area I would be very happy to engage with Claire Baker and any member further on.
Mark Roscoe.
Thanks. Empty town centre properties are being repurposed into spaces to house artist studios, venues and workshops, including Fire Station Creative in Dunfermline and Creative Stirling's Hub. Can I ask how the Culture Organisations and Venues Recovery Fund has directly supported these types of initiatives, and what further support can be offered to provide a viable future for our town centres?
Minister.
On the specific question that the member raises, I do not have that detail in front of me, though I will be happy to write to the member. But I do think the member raises a very, very important point. It is absolutely correct that we recognise that we do have a duty to support the cultural sector in recovery. But I think the cultural sector has a massive role to play in supporting town centres in recovering. And again, that is an area I would be very keen to take forward with the member and any other interested member in this chamber.
Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Minister agree that high street retailers operate at a severe disadvantage relative to online businesses in terms of paying rates, for example? Given that taxing online retailers is reserved, is the Scottish Government urging its UK counterparts to enact such a policy, actively pursuing any revenues which would then accrue to Scotland, and ultimately the devolution of such a power?
Minister.
Can I thank Mr Gibson for his question? We recognise the concerns raised regarding a level playing field for all, and Government is committed to supporting all businesses, including those delivering online services. For this reason, we have committed to explore the introduction of a new national digital sales tax in our recent manifesto, and we'll be looking into this complex area.
Question number 5, Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what additional support it will provide to the hospitality sector to mitigate against the impact of COVID-19 restrictions.
Minister Ivan McKee.
Thank you for the question. The Finance Secretary announced on 2 June up to £12 million additional funding for the 14 local authorities that are remaining in Level 2. Should restrictions continue to the end of June, and payments will be processed on a weekly basis. This included £4.5 million for the events and wedding sectors, and up to £7.4 million to support hospitality businesses with grants of between £350 and £525 per week for businesses required to modify their operations in Level 2.
Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The support in the short term the Minister refers to, and also today's announcement that hospitality premises ensuring Euro matches that go into extra time can open a bit longer will be welcomed by those businesses that receive the support, but it still excludes far too many others. And you know, even when restrictions are lifted on August the 9th, that won't be enough for many small hospitality businesses. So does the Minister accept that what we need is a proper recovery plan for small businesses, including hospitality, that covers long-term support, reform of business rates, which penalises hospitality, and other measures to help get those local firms back on their feet?
Minister.
Well, the member will be aware that we are keen to do all we can to support the sector, and I've met with various stakeholder groups within the sector over the last 2 or 3 weeks to discuss these very issues. As funds become available through consequentials from UK Government, we shall, of course, ensure that the sector is supported to the best of our ability. And as the member rightly identifies, recovery from the pandemic is hugely important. That is why we are putting significant focus on our economic transformation strategy that we are working through the details of at the moment. We'll address these very issues, how we build this sector and sectors right across the economy to not only recover from the pandemic, but to transform the economy in Scotland to the economy we want to see.
Jamie Halker-Johnson.
Thank you. While hospitality are now open, they are still facing many restrictions and lower customer footfall and significant barriers to trading. So can the Minister indicate what analysis of the Scottish Government has conducted into the levels of operating loss faced by businesses in the sector? And also, can he advise of any Scottish Government analysis on the proportion of that loss covered by supports, grants and loans the Scottish Government has provided?
Minister.
Well, first point to make clear, of course, is that the purpose of the support that we provide cannot, of course, cover the losses for every business right across the sector. As indicated, we pass on the consequentials that come from UK Government. A total of £3.6 billion has been used to support businesses through the course of the pandemic. With regards to analysis of the impact on this sector and across the wider economy, we are engaging in discussions with the financial services sector, who are best placed to understand the levels of debt that has been suffered by businesses across the economy, to look at this not only at a macro level across the economy, but also to conduct sector analysis to understand the differential impact across specific sectors of the economy.
Emma Harper.
I welcome the announcement yesterday from the First Minister regarding changes to wedding guidance. And weddings are key to the hospitality sector, and I've been contacted by wedding venues in the south of Scotland regarding whether a specific route map out of COVID-19 could be created for the wedding sector to meet the diversity of weddings and wedding venues. Is this something the Minister could consider, and could he outline if this would be possible and potential timeframes for it to be established?
Minister.
A number of changes were announced yesterday that will benefit the wedding sector. From 28 June, wedding suppliers will no longer be included in the numerical cap. Focused entertainment will also be allowed, provided guests are all seated at the sections. These have been key asks from the sector, as the member knows. Wedding reception guidance was updated on 22 June to set out clearly what these changes mean for weddings. When removed beyond level zero, almost all COVID restrictions will be removed for businesses and individuals. And this will mean that weddings can take place with dancing and singing as before the pandemic. Some baseline measures will remain, including good hygiene and surface cleaning and continued compliance with test and protect. More guidance on these baseline measures will be provided prior to moving beyond level zero.
Question number six, Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it is supporting the growth of jobs that will support a greener economy.
Minister Richard Lockhead.
We are committed to ensuring our transition to net zero creates new opportunities for people across the country, and our £100 million Green Jobs Fund is supporting green employment and creating opportunities for individuals to retrain and upskill in new and high growth areas. And we're also investing £26 million to develop the Energy Transition Zone in Aberdeen, which is expected to directly support 2,500 green jobs by 2030, alongside a further 10,000 transition-related jobs. So we're continuing to deliver on this ambition, which will be key to achieving the changes we need to meet our climate change targets and deliver a just transition.
Maurice Golden.
I thank the Minister for that response. By 2030, at least 60% of North Sea oil and gas platforms will be decommissioned, and over 1,500 wind turbines will be at the end of their life. The Scottish Government's own analysis shows decommissioning could support over 18,000 green jobs. So can the Minister confirm that all of this work will be carried out here in Scotland?
Minister.
The reason why we are creating a £100 million Green Jobs Fund, as well as the Energy Transition Fund, which, as indicated, is benefiting the North East and Aberdeen particularly significantly already, is because we want Scotland to gain the maximum economic benefits from the just transition between now and 2045 or between now and 2030, as the member highlights. So I'm confident we'll create a lot more green jobs for Scotland. It's going to require a Herculean effort, but for the sake of the planet and for Scotland's economy and our people, we will make substantial progress. But we have to work collaboratively with the local agencies and all the institutions in Aberdeen and academia and everyone else, and I'm sure we'll do that.
Question number 8, Jackson Carlow.
I was going to say time was up, Presiding Officer, but thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the announcement that the UK-Australia Free Trade Agreement will remove tariffs of up to 5% on Scotch whisky.
Minister Ivan McKee.
We are, of course, keen to see all Scottish exports increase in line with our vision for trade. However, any potential gain for Scotch whisky is more than offset by the cost of the deal to our farming communities. And that is why it's vital that the UK Government involve the Scottish Government and other devolved administrations in these trade discussions to make sure that trade agreements are in the best interest of everyone across Scotland. It is well known that the deal has been celebrated in Canberra but concealed in London. And as we heard last week from the Australian Deputy Prime Minister, the big winners are Australian producers.
Jackson Carlow.
Can I thank Ivan McKee for that response? And when he gets time to get off his high horse, can I ask him just to focus on the aspect that I asked about, which is the opportunity for Scotch whisky? Australia was our 8th biggest market last year, with £113 million to the Scotch whisky industry. What specific conversations has he had since the announcement of the agreement with the Scotch whisky industry about how the Scottish Government can work with them to ensure that we maximise the opportunity? And assuming he's not bothered to do that, can he commit to do that in the weeks ahead?
Minister?
I have an ongoing discussion with the SWA, as Jackson Carlow should know, about how we maximise the opportunities for all Scotch products, including Scotch whisky, globally. I've engaged extensively with them around the challenges they have seen with regards to US tariffs and the Scotch whisky industry. I've got a representative on my trade board, so don't lecture me about engagement with the Scotch whisky industry. This is something that we do on an ongoing and regular basis. But the key point about this trade deal is that the UK Government haven't published their impact assessment in full. And the reason for that, of course, is the significant impact, negative impact, that this trade deal in its entirety has for the Scottish economy and through our farming communities. That's what's important, and that's why it's important that the UK Government needs to engage with the devolved administrations to make sure that Scottish interests are taken into account in these trade deals.
Very brief supplementary from Michelle Thompson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Does the Minister agree that no free trade deal is ever completely free, and that this Australia deal comes at a particularly high cost for Scotland, including in terms of lowering standards for consumers?
Minister.
Absolutely, and we know that trade deals involve trade-offs, but the Scottish Government has had no involvement at all in these decisions. We've argued consistently that any trade agreement must protect our food, welfare and environmental standards, and that any imports must be produced to equivalent standards to Scottish production. It would be unacceptable if our current high standards suffered as a result of this deal, and it's vital that the UK Government share the full detail of what has been agreed with Australia.
Thank you, Minister. And that concludes portfolio questions on finance and the economy. I now move to portfolio questions on education and skills. And again, if during the relevant question the member would wish to request a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button or indicate R in the chat function. Question number 1, Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it plans to provide secure, sustainable and long-term post-COVID-19 pandemic skills and training opportunities.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
Skills is a key priority for this Government. Last week we met one of our first 100 days commitments, announcing a further £20 million for upskilling and retraining through our National Transition Training Fund. We are investing across the whole skills system, including our colleges and universities, to deliver learning opportunities to equip our workforce for the jobs of the future, in addition to over £2 billion allocated for post-school provision in 2021-22. We've committed an additional £500 million in this Parliament to support skills and employment.
Dean Lockhart.
The Minister will be aware of the latest numbers showing that Fair Start Scotland scheme has resulted in only 9%
of participants remaining in employment after 26 weeks. This low level of employment under the scheme has been a feature of the scheme since it was introduced 3 years ago, before the pandemic. Does the Minister acknowledge these disappointing results in terms of employment from the Fair Start scheme, and what steps will he take to improve the performance of that scheme?
Well, I'm Minister. Sure Richard Lochhead, my ministerial colleague who has responsibility for that scheme, will be delighted to provide an update to Mr Lockhart. What I am always struck by is the Tories' unwillingness to recognise the fundamentally different approach we have taken with employability programmes by comparison to them in government, where they coerce and compel some of the most vulnerable people in our society to take part in employability programmes at threat of losing their benefit entitlement. That's not an approach we'll ever take, and it's an approach I'm proud of.
Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Deputy President Officer. To ask the Scottish Government when the National Qualifications Group agreed on the appeals process for the 2021 National Qualifications and whether the decision was unanimous.
Minister.
Sorry, I actually didn't quite catch that question, Presiding Officer.
Sorry, I thought
you'd moved on to question number two, Presiding Officer.
So I apologise for that, and will perhaps take on question number one, a supplementary from Colette Stevenson. This is going well. Who has not pressed? So we'll now move on actually to question number two, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether demonstrated attainment from the 2020-2021 school year will be used in determining learner grades.
Cabinet Secretary.
This Government's absolute priority has been and remains to ensure that our young people are kept safe and are able to achieve fair and credible grades in spite of the most challenging of school years. The professional judgments of teachers and lecturers based on what learners have demonstrated they have attained is at the heart of this year's approach. Learners' grades this year will be judged by their teachers based on the evidence of their work. If a learner demonstrates they deserve a certain grade, then that's what they shall receive.
Paul Sweeney.
Well, teachers and pupils have been contacting me in distress and under pressure due to what one teacher called exams by stealth. One pupil who contacted me likened the approach from the SQA to gaslighting. These concerns have been compounded by the elimination of last year's results from the historic grade boundaries. It feels to me that the government is about to fail the most disadvantaged pupils again in an unforgivable dereliction of duty. Most shameful of all, they appear to be trying to shift the blame onto teachers. There is no room for teacher judgment. Estimate grades must be evidence-based. So will the Cabinet Secretary now do what must be done to avoid the mistakes of last year and agree that we need to scrap pre-moderation, allow teachers to professionally determine grades without constraints, and introduce a no-detriment appeals process?
Cabinet Secretary.
The model that we have in the alternative certification model has been co-produced with the National Qualifications 21 group, and that does include teachers' representation on that. They specifically asked, as part of that process, that this was about demonstrated attainment. So that is directly against what teachers' representatives asked for as part of that process. We have worked very carefully with stakeholders, including teachers, but also with young people as we've moved through that process. I appreciate there have been differences of opinion around part of the appeals process, and there's a question on that later, which I'll perhaps leave the details on that for, Presiding Officer, but I certainly remain committed to ensuring that young people have faith, as they absolutely should do, in a fair and credible process that has been worked with stakeholders and the SQA to deliver that for them.
Supplementary, Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Cabinet Secretary when she became aware local authorities were excluding 2020 exam results when using historical data to moderate grades this year, and if she was aware that the SQA discussed the use of statistical analysis with local authority directors of education ahead of quality assurance models being designed and adopted.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, there has been, I appreciate, a great deal of speculation around historical data is being used, but I would once again say that it's part of a quality assurance process which can be undertaken by local authorities that helps identify patterns and trends that can be used for local quality assurance to prompt discussions around attainment and achievement. That historical data is important because it can support teachers and head teachers to be confident around their judgment based against a national standard. The important aspect of this, as always, is to ensure that young people themselves know that if their demonstrated attainment has demonstrated a grade, then that's the grade they will get. Historical data is not being used as an algorithm to change their grades, either by the school or indeed by the SQA.
Fiona Hislop.
Following the OECD's report, a proposal that Scotland's assessment system needs to match the 21st century curriculum, what is the Education Secretary's response to the call from Maureen McKenna, one of Scotland's leading educationalists and Glasgow Council's Executive Director of Education, for a big debate on whether teachers' continuous assessments should play an ongoing greater role in pupils' final grades and qualifications in the future?
Cabinet Secretary.
As I mentioned in my statement yesterday, there are no decisions that have been taken around what any reform of the qualifications or assessment approach would look like in the future. And that's because we have the second OECD report on a comparative analysis of assessment and qualifications approaches due by the end of August. When that comes through, I will absolutely commit to engaging with stakeholders, including, of course, Maureen McKenna, if she wishes to do so, to discuss future plans for senior phase qualifications and awards.
Question number three, Natalie Dawn.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support is available for students impacted by COVID-19.
Minister, Jamie Hepburn.
I understand the significant impact the pandemic has had on students, and as a result of this, many students are facing financial difficulties with accommodation, associated costs or challenges in getting jobs. In direct response to this, we have now committed an additional £20 million to help alleviate the financial pressures facing many students over the summer period. The support provided to students over the course of the pandemic has been substantial, with over £96 million being provided via hardship funds, digital access, mental health support and support for student associations.
Natalie Dawn.
Thank the Minister for that response. The COVID pandemic has severely impacted many students and it's magnified the financial burdens that some students face during the summer. As the SNP continue to prioritise improving the attainment gap in Scotland, providing this summer support to students is a really, really positive step towards achieving this. Many students find themselves in debt over the summer months and not all have the capability to find work, sustain their accommodation or take up training or volunteering opportunities relevant to their degree, as they simply can't afford to do so. So this puts some students at a disadvantage to their peers that can, based on their financial situation rather than their actual learning ability. Can the Minister provide an update on the timescale for the review of any future summer support for students taking place, as was outlined in the plan for the first 100 days of government?
Minister.
Well, Ms Dawn has rightly laid out that this is a commitment we've made in the first 100 days to commence the review of summer support. We will, of course, be engaging with the relevant stakeholders across the sector to help inform the review, considering all of the relevant factors when making any decisions. I've already had dialogue with the National Union of Students, and we touched on a range of matters this subject, included, of course, continue to engage with them. We are committed to beginning that review in the first 100-day period. Then, when it's concluded, we'll, of course, respond, and I look forward to updating Parliament on that in due course.
Thank you. Question number four, Alex Riley.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the NASUWT Scotland survey, which suggests that 53% of teachers have considered leaving the profession in the last year, feeling demoralised, unsupported and unrecognised.
Cabinet Secretary.
We recognise the pressure on teachers and appreciate the extraordinary contribution in the most challenging of circumstances. We have already committed over £400 million to education recovery and introduced a support package for schools on mental health support for staff. We are committed to supporting the employment of an additional 3,500 teachers and classroom assistants and reducing teachers' weekly class contact time by 1.5 hours to reduce workload and enable more time for planning. We will continue to put the health and wellbeing of pupils and staff at the forefront of our recovery plans and work constructively with all stakeholders, including the NUSUWT.
Alex Riley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I do welcome that answer, and I do wish the Cabinet Secretary well in addressing the crisis that we have within education. The EIS, I notice, have put forward a proposal at their conference where they are talking about reducing class sizes over a period of time, but putting specific timelines in, and over 9 years getting those classes right across Scotland down to at least 20. Does the Cabinet Secretary support that? Does she support the principle that we have to get more resources into the classroom? And will she put a time limit on when we will start to see new teachers coming into the classroom, as well as a massive increase in teacher assistance?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, we're absolutely determined to move very quickly on the number of teachers and classroom assistants. That's why we moved, as part of our COVID recovery work, to already deliver additional teachers and classroom assistants. And once again, on top of that, another first 100 days commitment of this parliamentary term will be to fund councils to increase teacher numbers by 1,000 and classroom assistants by 500. I do absolutely appreciate the points that Alec Rowley has made in his supplementary question, and the need for the Scottish Government and our agencies to ensure that we are supporting teachers at that time. And I hope I can provide him with reassurance that that is something that I take very seriously and something we are moving very quickly to do.
Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would like to ask the Scottish Government its views on the link between improving teacher morale, support and recognition in relation to the comments in the OECD Curriculum for Excellence report. The report states a need to provide dedicated time to lead plan support curriculum for excellence at the school level. And this supports what I'm hearing locally from teachers in Uddingston and Vale's Hill constituency. They're telling me that increased planning time improves the quality of lessons that are delivered to our children. And while the teacher workload was not raised with the OECD team, Scotland's teachers have been at the highest rates of class contracts across OECD countries. And the report actually stated...
Could we get a question, please?
Yep, certainly. For all teachers, for curriculum planning, for monitoring the student achievement and support and moderation. So while the teachers...
Could we please... Ms Callaghan, could we please have a question, please? Thank you.
Yeah, certainly. So will the Scottish Government commit today to prioritising a reasonable reduction in class contact time for Scotland's teachers? Thanks.
Cabinet Secretary.
As I mentioned as part of my answer to Alec Rowley, we have indeed committed to reducing teachers' class contact time by 1.5 hours per week. That was in the manifesto that we stood on. We're proud to deliver on that. And we are, of course, investing in more teachers. That will ensure that we are supporting the OECD's recommendation around dedicated time for school staff to lead to plan and support the curriculum. We've begun those discussions through the Scottish Negotiating Committee for Teachers on how this reduction in class contact time can be most effectively achieved, and I certainly hope that we can do that in the very near future.
Thank you. Question number 5, Liam MacArthur. Joining us remotely, I hope.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support it's providing to schools to enable them to hold modified sports events that can be attended by parents and carers.
Cabinet Secretary.
We know that end-of-year events such as sport days are important to children and young people, as well as to many parents and carers. In light of current clinical advice, it is also important we keep schools as safe as possible until the end of term. As always, this involves balancing competing risks and priorities. Our guidance for schools continues to reflect public health expert advice to minimise the number of contacts that children and staff have. This means class sports days are able to go ahead and be enjoyed, but that spectator attendance must be via digital means such as school secure online platforms.
Liam MacArthur.
Thank you. As the Cabinet Secretary will be aware, Orkney has been in level zero for some time, yet parents have been prevented from attending sports days at schools and nurseries across the county. At a time when fan zones were being given the go-ahead by ministers, the curb on attending sports days has caused understandable anger and confusion. So why was more not done to help facilitate perhaps smaller scale events that would allow parents to attend? And can it really be said that a risk-based approach is being taken where guidance is applied uniformly across the country?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Liam MacArthur for that question? I do appreciate this has been an issue which has concerned many members across the Chamber. I absolutely recognise the importance of events to mark the end of a key stage in a child or a young person's life, and very careful consideration has been given to this. The current guidance has been considered very recently once again by the COVID Education Recovery Group and by the Advisory Subgroup on Education and Children's Issues. We're not able to recommend changes to the position at that time, but I do understand that many schools have made plans within the guidance. One of the reasons that we've not been able to suggest and propose a change in that is that we know if cases are identified within an education setting, then they can often disrupt the whole setting, with perhaps many children and young people and teachers having to self-isolate. Of course, many early years establishments, of course, run right throughout the summer. And that's the reason for the decision around educational establishments and our absolute priority that we have in keeping early year centres, schools open as much as possible and not requiring staff or students and pupils to self-isolate.
Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Last week I raised concerns in relation to parents and guardians who are still unable to attend their child's nursery and school graduation or sports days. Can I therefore ask if the Scottish Government will produce the evidence which states that it is not safe for parents to attend before parliamentary recess, given that the First Minister assured members that this would be made available?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, certainly happy to ensure that the member is directed to the advice that we have and the guidance that's came out and the minutes of the Education Recovery Group. I think I've stated the reasons for the decision of that group and of the advisory subgroup on education and children's issues not to recommend to ministers a change in that guidance. So I won't rehearse that again, Presiding Officer, but it is something, of course, that we will keep under review to see if changes can be made for the new academic year.
Thank you. Michael Mara.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. A key issue in holding school events is COVID testing levels. Does the government believe that the low number of COVID testing in schools has led to more disruption to young people's education?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Michael Mara for that question, because it's something which I have kept a very close eye on. We do believe that there is an under-reporting of COVID testing levels within schools, both from pupils and staff, because there is an under-reporting of when a person gets a negative test. So certainly we've discussed this at great length at the Education Recovery Group about this, and that is one of the reasons which both the unions and Public Health Scotland and other members of the groups think that we are looking at a lower level of results coming through than perhaps is what's happening in the area. But it is something which we've been very keen to press, and I'd like to thank the unions for their work to encourage their staff to take that up, and for ADES and for others within local authorities to encourage that, and to ensure that we're keeping that right up until the summer holidays. And we're already looking at what needs to be done to ensure that testing is high, as we would like it to be, as we move into the next academic year. But it is something I am keeping an exceptionally close eye on, because I would also like to see the figures be higher than they are.
Question number six, Paul O'Kane, and I do apologise for the earlier confusion, Mr O'Kane.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I knew that two Pauls in the Labour group would get confusing at some point, but can I ask the Scottish Government when the National Qualifications Group agreed on the appeals process for the 2021 National Qualifications and whether the decision was unanimous?
Cabinet Secretary.
The alternative certification model for this year has been co-produced by the National Qualifications 2021 group to deliver the best possible approach under the circumstances to ensure learners' hard work is recognised fairly. On the approach to appeals, there has been a range of views expressed following what was an extensive consultation on draft proposals. As has been apparent, some group members do not support the approach being taken, while others do. Jim Thewlis, the General Secretary of School Leaders Scotland, for example, is clear that SLS are fully behind the model as the best approach possible and fully behind the approach being taken on appeals.
Paul O'Kane.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and I note what she says about some members of the group. But the Government has said that a rights-respecting approach is at the heart of our recovery from the pandemic. So it's therefore disappointing and frustrating that Cameron Garrett from the Scottish Youth Parliament, who was the only young person on the National Qualifications Group, has said that young people have been ignored in the formulation of the process. The views of young people and of upholding their rights should be amongst our top priorities in this Parliament. So can the Minister set out if there were any other dissenting views within the National Qualifications 21 Group regarding appeals?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I said in my original answer, there were a number of thoughts on the appeals process and the different parts of that appeals process. So it's not a binary choice on this issue. There were a great deal of different thoughts about different areas on it. One of the things that I looked at as I reassured myself around what was happening and was this a fair and credible process. Now, I appreciate that Cameron and others within the Scottish Youth Parliament wanted a no detriment right where the grades couldn't go down. I don't think that that's fair and credible, because I don't think it's fair on the young people who perhaps haven't put in a repeal, because what we're having then is somebody who's looking at that appeal, not looking at the whole evidence, but looking at part of that evidence. And I don't think that, therefore, is fair for all learners. So I absolutely appreciate that on this occasion I took a different view to the young people that were represented on that. I can reassure them that I listened very carefully to that. They were not ignored. There was a genuine difference of opinion on this, but I do look forward to working with Cameron and with others as we move forward with the policies that we have on education, because, as I said yesterday, I am determined to put them at the heart of that. It may not necessarily mean that we will agree on every occasion, but they will absolutely be at the heart of the policy making that we have within education the Government.
Thank you. And I will take questions 7 and 8 if we can approach both the questions and the answers on the part of the questioners and the Cabinet Secretary with some brevity. Question 7, Jenny Mint.
To ask the Scottish Government what its plans are for future investment in the school estate.
Cabinet Secretary.
Scottish Government officials are currently preparing options for my consideration regarding Phase 3 of the £2 billion Learning Estate Investment Programme. I expect to make an announcement later this year on the timescales for Phase 3.
Jenny Binto.
I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. All over Argyll and Bute, we have excellent schools. They are fantastic places to learn. However, in the islands of Isla, Mull and Tyree, our high school estate needs upgrading. Our teachers are the best, and our children's school staff deserve a building that mirrors the excellence taught inside. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that the quality of teaching must be mirrored by the quality of the buildings, and funding should be forthcoming?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm determined that Scotland's pupils have access to high-quality, up-to-date facilities that school communities can be proud of. And I can reassure Jenny Minto that any bid for funding from Argyll and Bute Council through Phase 3 of the Learning Estate Investment Programme will, of course, be given careful consideration.
Question number 8, Willie Rennie.
Ask the Scottish Government whether funding allocations earmarked to new and existing teaching posts will be made permanent to enable local authorities to award a greater number of permanent contracts.
Cabinet Secretary.
We are working closely with COSLA regarding the employment of teachers for the next academic year, and as employers, local authorities are currently undertaking an assessment of staff requirements to support education recovery. As employers, the recruitment and deployment of teachers and other support staff in local authority schools is a matter for individual councils. Our education system is reliant on the hard work and dedication of our teachers, and I recognise the effort and resilience they have shown to support learners during this pandemic. I'm firmly of the view that we will need all possible teaching resources at our disposal to support education recovery, and I would expect employment opportunities to be available.
Willie Rennie.
Cabinet Secretary completely dodged my question. I was asking whether she's prepared to make the funding permanent so the teaching posts could be made permanent. If the funding's temporary, It's a no-brainer that you're going to get temporary posts as well. So will she change the policy and allow local authorities to make these teaching posts permanent? The teaching profession, as we've already heard, is utterly depressed. It's been treated very poorly by this government. Is it going to change its ways?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'll say to Willie Rennie exactly what the First Minister said to Willie Rennie as he raised this issue a few weeks ago. She said, and I will reiterate once again, that we need all possible teaching resources at our disposal as we move to education recovery. We are taking the COVID education recovery as a government exceptionally seriously, and that is why I would expect permanent employment opportunities to be the priority of the local authorities, as does the First Minister.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And that concludes portfolio questions on education.